Hachette Audio presents The Joy of Pizza. Everything you need to know. Written by Dan Richer with Katie Parla. Read by Will Collyer. Includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF of recipes and bonus material. Introduction. The Joy of Pizza. Pizza makes people happy. It's a universally joyful food. Aside from being absolutely delicious, it brings people together around the table to share a communal experience laced with melted cheese. It's affordable, making it accessible to all. It satisfies on a physiological level, delivering the salt, fat, and acid that our brains and taste buds crave. It's a key part of America's social fabric, with nearly 3 billion pizzas consumed annually. And pizza is a part of some of my most treasured memories, and I'd wager many of yours, from post-soccer celebrations to birthday parties. This book is about finding even more joy in pizza by learning to make pizza well. I've spent 40 years eating pizza and 20 years making it professionally, every day trying to come closer to my platonic ideal. Truthfully, I find joy in pizza of all types, from Neapolitan to deep dish to New York-style slices. But I have landed on my absolute favorite approach to pizza. It transcends regional styles, and it brings me boundless joy to share it with my friends, family, and restaurant guests, not to mention how much I love eating it myself. I crave a rim that is crispy and deeply caramelized, and that shatters when my teeth bite through it. I want the crumb, interior of the crust, to be delicate, floral-scented, and flavorful, with a gentle and subtle note of acidity. I love a crust with nice, open holes, separated by thin, pearlescent cell walls. I want toppings that are not only balanced in flavor, but sourced from farmers and food producers I have relationships with, care for, and support. If all this sounds very specific, it is. But it's where my pizza journey has taken me. Just wait till you hear about the detailed pizza evaluation rubric we use every day at my restaurant, Razza, in Jersey City, New Jersey. How it started. I grew up eating slices cut from big, 20-inch pies from Pizza Village in a strip mall in Aberdeen, New Jersey. Every Tuesday and Friday, my family gathered around our table for takeout. I loved opening the box, the steam and savory cheese aromas escaping as we each grabbed a slice, sharing as a family. Pizza wasn't just a twice-weekly thing for the Richers. Inevitably, sometime during the week, I would run errands with my mom, Robin, and we would pop into Pizza Village or one of the many other strip mall pizzerias on our route to grab a slice, just the two of us. We would sit in a booth beneath posters of the Amalfi Coast or the Leaning Tower of Pisa tacked to the wall and faded by the sun and time. I always ordered a plain slice, and she would get the same, or a Bianca or a Sicilian square slice. The pizza itself wasn't remarkable by my current standards, but the joy of those memories dwells deep inside my DNA. Anyone who was close to their mother would look back with nostalgia on such simple, happy moments. But for me, they have profound significance. Mom passed away when I was 22 years old. I was fresh out of college and just off a life-changing trip to Italy with my cousin. Her death shattered me in ways I can't begin to describe. But it also gave me purpose and set me on my current path. I had moved back home for her final days and stuck around for the long, painful year that followed. The house was dark and joyless. My father coped by withdrawing, and my older brother confronted his grief in his own way. For me, I needed something to dull the pain. I threw myself headfirst into learning something new, how to cook. The antidote to my grief was cooking for my dad, brother, and friends. I became particularly obsessed. This adjective is a recurring theme in my life, with tomato sauce, determined to nail the perfect pasta condiment. To dial in the recipe, I channeled memories of my trip to Italy, where the sauces I had tasted were less intense and more balanced than the thick, garlic-laden, brick-hued Sunday gravy so popular in New Jersey. For a year, I practiced my sauce over and over, never satisfied and always seeking to improve on the previous batch. First, I ditched the tomato paste, then reeled in the garlic, each time tweaking ingredients and proportions. I must have made it 100 times that year. This all-out fixation with making tomato sauce distracted me from my sadness and brought the people I loved together for the support I desperately needed. Each pot of simmering sauce allowed me small glimpses of joy in an otherwise morose time. Only years later, with the guidance of a therapist, did I realize how my drive to repeat and improve on something as simple as a tomato sauce, and later pizza in general, was connected in a very deep way to my mom. Robin was a calligrapher. She spent hours each day at her workbench, tirelessly practicing and perfecting her script. I remember seeing pages on her desk of the same curve being practiced over and over. There was never a day when she rested on her laurels or stopped thinking about how she could do better with the next pen stroke. Her constant pursuit of improvement is one of her greatest legacies, and I honor her by approaching my craft with the same sense of dedication and near-maniacal drive. Pizza practice. In the years that followed, I worked at random restaurants in New Jersey. At 26, I begged, borrowed, and hustled to afford a struggling pizzeria. It became an extension of my home, albeit with a repertoire that went beyond tomato sauce. That first restaurant had two wood-fired ovens, so I taught myself to make pizza. The process of learning how to harness the power of flour and yeast was exhilarating, and I loved feeding a sourdough starter every day. Something about nurturing this living thing really appealed to me on a gut level. Making naturally leavened wood-fired pizzas is not the ideal place to start if you want to really understand pizza making. What's that saying about hindsight? And at first, I was overwhelmed by the learning curve. Nevertheless, learning this new craft and bringing people together over pizza brought me an immense joy that I hadn't felt in a long time. As I got more into pizza making, I began obsessing. Told you it was a theme. Over canned whole tomatoes. Eager to find the brand that worked best on a pizza, its moisture level, acidity, sweetness, and flavor. Then my obsession turned to mozzarella, how to slice it, its ideal proportion to the sauce, and then how to make my own. Pizza was no longer a single thing to me. It was the culmination of its components, each of which had its own world to understand and harness for creating a delicious final product. By the time I opened Razza Pizza Artigianale in Jersey City in 2012, I was totally consumed by the desire to not only make sauce, cheese, and dough that were better every day, but to share this experience with others. For the past decade, my staff and I have connected daily, rolling balls of dough, trading stories, and deepening our connection to one another. We have served hundreds of thousands of pizzas, watched our young guests grow up, and been a part of countless first dates, anniversaries, and reunions. We have become part of the community and have connected with farmers, food producers, and millers who support one another. I can't imagine anything more joyful than that. Pizza at home. You don't need to run out and buy a pizzeria to get in on this whole constellation of joyful pizza experiences. With only a home oven, a handful of tools, and a committed curiosity, anyone can make exceptional pizza. You don't have to master wood-fired baking either. Though if you do, I have some tips for that. It's easy enough to pull out some flour, canned tomatoes, and cheese and throw together a pizza. At the very least, it will be edible. But truly transcendent pizza comes from contemplating the ingredients, practicing the craft, learning from mistakes, and building on your successes. Don't be intimidated if you've never even baked pizza before. No other food is so perfect in its imperfections, so forgiving on its way to mastery. Learning and practicing pizza making is the gift that keeps on giving. You can make a pretty good pizza with any recipe in this book, but with consistent practice, your pizza can become exceptional. I highly recommend recruiting your friends and family to join you on the journey, rewarding them with pizza and all the joy it brings. What makes a perfect pie? My goal when making pizza, whether at Razza or in my home, is to make people happy. After all of these years of experience, I know that even mediocre pizza can spark joy, but not nearly as much as a pie that has been crafted with love and reverence for the craft. There's no such thing as the perfect pizza, of course, but that doesn't mean I can't try. Actually, it's the trial and error and the imperfections I create along the way that keep me endlessly fascinated by pizza making. A critical aspect to this lifelong quest has been the naming of my intentions. By thinking about and articulating precisely what I want each element of my pizza to feel and taste like on its own, as well as how it will work.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.